We reject the ideology of globalism, and we embrace the doctrine of patriotism.
Not only will this tax plan pay for itself, but it will pay down debt.
There are moral and legal obligation questions that I think we'll have to wrestle with as a society.
When we as people go wobbly on the truth, we go wobbly on America.
All you have to do is look at the numbers, look at what we've done.
And this is only the beginning.
From 100.9 FM WXIR, this is Evidence of Design, and I'm your host, Jason Taylor. Evidence of Design is a live talk show about the political economy. We critique income and wealth inequality and support democratic values. Thank you for listening, and welcome. Good morning, everyone. Happy Saturday, March 16th, 2019. You're listening to Evidence of Design on 100.9 FM WXIR in Rochester, New York. My name is Jason Taylor. I'm your host, and I'm joined by my good friends and co-hosts, Matt Treadwell.
Hello.
And Mary Lawrence.
Good morning.
This is episode 47 of Evidence of Design. You can find us in many places on YouTube, on our Evidence of Design YouTube channel. We have a Facebook, we have a Twitter, and we have an email, all the tags, Radio EOD. Normally, we would invite you to call in today. However, this episode is pre-recorded, so we are not live for you on this episode, but we have timely things to share, and we do hope that you enjoy this conversation. And the conversation that we are having about is basically public versus private. So for those who are new to the show, we talk about income and wealth inequality routinely on this show. We think it's very important to critique income and wealth inequality. It's not given enough attention in society, and that by looking at income and wealth inequality and by developing the vocabulary necessary to articulate why that inequality is happening and what the effects of that inequality has on us as a people living together in a shared society, we become better able to create a more just and verdant world. Now, in doing so, we talk a lot about something called neoliberalism. That is essentially the political and economic belief that's really been mainstream for the past 40 years in American society that basically says, look, if we have a smaller government and we have more things open to the free market, then society will be better off. If we have less government, more free market, things are better. That right there is a recipe for a rich conversation on public versus private. Government, of course, meaning public, and private, of course, meaning the free market. There's a lot more nuanced distinctions you can have, and we'll delve into those today by talking about particular institutions in our society. Is that right, Mary? Is there anything else we should add to our discussion?
Oh, I'm sure we'll get into it soon enough.
What institutions will we be looking at today?
So today we'll be looking at a few different institutions, such as transportation, very briefly, prisons, education, so both K-12 and university education, as well as healthcare.
So transportation, prisons, education, and healthcare. We're looking at all of those from the perspectives of public versus private.
And we should make a note that we are pre-recorded today.
Yes, we already mentioned that, Matt. Thanks for bringing that up again for listeners.
Just so you know.
Just a reminder. We're here from the past at your present.
Hello. From 3 days ago.
So today, folks, yes, we're talking about public versus private on a few institutions. We also talked last week about some of the Democratic contenders entering the race for president. There are, well, I think we're up to 15 now with Joe Biden entering the race. So there's, as of this recording, there's 15 mainstream candidates running for the Democratic presidential seat in 2020. And so in talking about all these institutions, transportation, prisons, healthcare, and education, we're also wondering in this conversation, what do you want your chosen candidate to think about those institutions in terms of public versus private? Yeah, what should they prioritize? What should your chosen candidate prioritize in those institutions? Let's have this discussion. Matt, are we ready to take it away?
Oh, we are.
Let's do it.
I hear the train a-coming. It's rolling around a bend. And I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps a-rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry.
And that was Folsom Prison Blues by Johnny Cash.
And you're listening to 100.9 FM WXIR in Rochester. This is Evidence of Design. We're talking about public versus private today, looking at various institutions in society, and what are the pros and cons of them being run more publicly or more privately? Mary, do we want to start out with one particular institution, and you can introduce us to sort of the perspectives and the debate on public versus private in the institution?
Absolutely. So I actually want to go right off with our music and start along with prisons. And I actually want to start with a quotation from the ACLU, that's the American Civil Liberties Union, that focuses on private prisons. So, while the nation's unprecedented rate of imprisonment deprives individuals of freedom, wrests loved ones from their families, and drains the resources of governments, communities, and taxpayers, the private prison industry reaps lucrative rewards. As the public good suffers from mass incarceration, private prison companies obtain more and more government dollars, and private prison executives at the leading companies rake in enormous compensation packages. Private prison companies essentially admit that their business model depends on locking up more and more people. The American economy should not include locking people in cages for profit. So there we get a little bit of an idea of where we're going to be heading today in the prison conversation. But I do want to briefly mention that our general definitions of public, as Jason said earlier, that would be something that would be related to government. So public services would generally be services paid through government subsidies or through public taxes, so things that we would pay for. And our definition of private, as we just mentioned with private prisons, these are services paid for through shareholders, private investors, and sales, though sometimes private organizations do receive government funding as well. And that is something that we should be aware of when thinking of public versus private. So turning to prison specifically, in the United States, we actually have the highest prison population in the world. There are around 2 million people in prison, and about 8% of that 2 million is held in private prisons. Those private prisons are for profit. So again, that means that they are holding people incarcerated as a business.
Now, 2 million Americans in prison is a lot. There's 325 million Americans. So that's like one out of every 100 Americans that are in prison. That's insane, right?
It is absolutely insane.
2 million Americans are in jail.
Yes. So I do want to say as a note before I look at public versus private of prisons, while the other institutions we might have more of a benefit of public institutions versus private institutions, for the prison system, I think that there needs to be a huge overhaul of prisons in general and really looking at why people are imprisoned and, you know, making that change. But I would like to look at the differences between the two types of institutions briefly.
Sure.
So for public prisons, these, as I mentioned, would be owned and operated by local state or federal governments, and these are run as nonprofit organizations. So that means since the government controls them, the government controls which prison inmates would be sent to. They have the ability to release inmates early. The operations are directly funded by the government, and they are required to make certain information about the prison available to the public in order to provide taxpayers with an idea of how their money is being used. And that, I think, is critical, because that is a big difference between public and private prisons, is that public prisons have to be transparent about how they're using taxpayer money. On the other hand, private prisons are often for-profit facilities. They're run by private third-party companies, but they receive money from the government. So these government contracts are based on the number of inmates and the average length of time served. To translate, that means that for-profit prisons have an incentive to hold inmates longer and to hold more of them. So these prisons are less likely to report data on the inmate population, staffing, or where budget was spent. Again, these are not, they don't answer to taxpayers, so they don't have to be transparent about their practices. The government pays the prison for the inmates' daily costs. So they do still receive government funding, even though they don't have to tell the taxpayers where that money is going.
Is that government funding their primary source of income?
You know, that is a good question. I don't actually know where their funding primarily comes from, but I would imagine that would be a big deal of it if the government is paying for, if the government is paying for the general costs of having inmates. I would imagine that that would be a pretty big source of their funding. One thing that is interesting about these prisons as well is that they are able to accept or decline any inmate or potential inmate. Whereas, you know, in public circumstances, the government would just say, you know, this inmate is going to this prison. For the private institution, each institution is able to say, look, we don't want this prisoner. And often that happens when inmates have mental health issues, because they cost more to house, because they need more treatment. They might need, you know, more space.
A wider range of services.
Exactly. They would also tend to choose less violent offenders. So they're a little bit more choosy in who they have.
Just like charter schools.
Yeah, and we'll get to those. So generally, there are arguments that private prisons are worse for inmate rights, because they don't have to be as transparent with their practices.
Sure.
And they have a very high need of qualified correctional officers. So probably because they don't have, you know, they're run more as a business than a government institution. So they may not have the state funding for their workers.
Is there, and I don't mean to put you on the spot, Mary, although I do, is there a court case, or what is the history behind when private prisons sort of started in America?
You know, that's a great question, and I don't have an answer for it right now.
I don't know either, but I do know that there's a documentary called 13th, and the documentary kind of goes into that, where the private prison practice, kind of the modern instantiation of privatized prisons, has really come out of how we started this episode talking about neoliberalism, mm-hmm. and the trend towards privatization, where the private prison industry is coming out of that larger scale societal trend to privatize things. There's something called rent seeking or capital conversion. Both of those terms are not interchangeable, but the idea is, how do you marketize and commoditize as many things as possible? And so you can take a prison population, and you could look at the prison population and say, how could anyone make money off of the prison population? And well, there's a million ways you can do that. Should you? That's a different question. But of course, you know, the privatized prison industry is a great example of arguably rent seeking. People are figuring out, how can I make money off of something? Well, let's privatize it.
Yeah. I don't necessarily want to be, you know, quoted, even though I'm speaking on the radio, but I do believe that this started sometime in the 70s. I don't know a specific date, but I don't think that private prisons have been around for quite as long as the public institutions.
I would assume not as well, and I'm equally unfamiliar with it. I wanted to ask, and this is more of a feels question for the both of you, because...
I love feels questions.
Yes. it seems to me, I mean, I would assume that the methodology or the way in which private prisons operate is fairly unknown to most of the American public, because I feel like the idea that a business is essentially profitable based on the number of people it confines, that seems totally at odds with the ideals and values that we claim to stand for in America. So I'm just wondering, do you think that part of the reason why private prisons exist to begin with is because there's not a lot of visibility for them?
I would give that an affirmative.
That idea, the fact that they don't have to be transparent, I think would also play into that lack of visibility.
So I do have to say, I think that mass incarceration in general is a huge problem. And I think that often in this country, we have this sort of ideal of prisons as being a place where, you know, people go there when they do bad things and then they become invisible. And I do think that's problematic, and private prisons just sort of play into that. I wasn't extremely aware of private prisons until probably, I don't know, last year. I didn't even know that there were for-profit prisons. It doesn't make sense to me that it would be an institution that, you know, would be for-profit.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And I think that the point of these privatized prisons is to make the problem invisible. And I think a lot of people in society are fine with that, right? Because if someone commits a crime, it's like, well, they gave up their right to fulfill our social contract, and they should be punished for it. I'm not saying I agree with that or that's okay, but I'm saying I know there's a narrative out there where people who go to prison deserve to be in prison, and who cares what happens to them when they're there, because they did their due.
Yeah, I'd like to say I outright disagree with that.
Yeah, I agree. And listeners, if you're just tuning in to having controversial discussions on 100.9 FM WXIR in Rochester, this is Evidence of Design, and we're talking about public versus private today. So we're talking about what it means for different institutions in our society, like the prison industry, like education, like transportation, and like healthcare, to be either public or private. And so we're having these discussions today. We're talking about the prison industry right now. And so, Mary, anything else that we should think about when it comes to the private prison industry? You laid out some of the sort of the pros and cons of prisons being public institutions, pros and cons of prisons being a private institution. Anything else we should add to this conversation?
I think the most important point that I want to drive home in talking about prisons specifically is that private prisons have a lot of issues, but so do prisons in general. And I think that when we're having a conversation about what to change, we shouldn't only focus, I mean, I think that we should get rid of private prisons personally. I don't think that it's okay that we have prisons that don't have to be transparent. I don't think it's okay that they are allowed to or incentivized to hold more prisoners for longer terms just because that is what makes them money. I think that's not okay. But I do think that in general, prisons need to, like, the prison system needs to be looked over and changed.
Yeah, I agree with you on two. I want to make two points here. The first is that when right now we have immigrant detention centers on the U.S. border, and there's been a lot of news stories about, there's a sort of a famous private one. I forgot. I think it's in Florida, honestly. I should know more about this, but, you know, right now we're having a huge national discussion and tension over where we house illegal immigrants, right? And I don't really agree with that terminology, but that you could call them that. And so those would be public in some ways, right? It's run by the federal government. And so you're saying, Mary, I hear you saying that, well, you know, prisons in general can be relooked, how our justice system is
absolutely
kind of operating, particularly the private prison systems, which are maybe not under the same accountability requirements as public systems. Which brings me to my second point, which is even those very accountability or incentive systems in our society are kind of fundamentally broken. For example, food pantries will often get grants and funding based upon how many people they serve, which is a great thing, right? You want to serve people with the services you provide. The problem is that do you really want to report an increasing number of people you serve as a food pantry? Like, doesn't that indicate the fact that society is fundamentally broken such that people need your service to begin with? And so the problem with a lot of our nonprofits and other sort of large institutions like that is we're essentially rewarding failure. And so public institutions shouldn't, or I'm sorry, prisons shouldn't be rewarded for more inmates, right? Like, that to me sounds a little odd. In some ways, we should be punishing ourselves for having more inmates in these systems or for food pantries, you know? Yeah, we should, or Matt just said, you know, we shouldn't
at least not incentivize it. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So I don't know the solution to that, but we should at least have the conversation being like, wait, why are we offering more money to this prison system that is incarcerating more people? That's confusing to me.
I think if you're someone who believes the perhaps idealized perspective that prisons are a place of reform where we send people to get better, to improve their behavior and to re-enter society, then for-market prisons or for-profit prisons rather, I think are fundamentally irreconcilable with that worldview.
So who do you both want to see then in a candidate running for president? You hear all the time that candidates say, I want comprehensive criminal justice reform. And you're like, what does that mean? Is there something that you, Matt or Mary, want to see in a candidate running for office when it comes to criminal justice or the prison industry?
That is a good question. I think being more specific than having just criminal justice reform is important. I think an active desire to counteract mass incarceration would be one good move. I think making a move to change drug laws would probably be huge, actually. Whether or not we're looking at legalizing, the way that we criminalize drug use, even on a personal basis, would be something that, you know, that obviously contributes to mass incarceration. And so even looking at issues that sort of border mass incarceration or the prison system would be useful.
I was also going to say drug reform. I'm not sure that if we've ever done it before on the air, Jason, but I know that you and I have talked at length in our private lives about how different demographics of people are targeted or receive different levels of service or prison sentences just based on race, for example. People of color are much more likely to both be prosecuted for drug crimes and to serve longer sentences than white people. And I think that something that a candidate who is willing to acknowledge that disparity is something that I would look for.
Yeah, I'd agree with that, Matt.
Well said. So listeners, on 100.9 FM WXIR, we're talking about public versus private today, looking at various institutions in society, inclusive of prisons, the transportation system, education, and healthcare, and the merits or cons of those institutions being more public or more private, and also wondering, well, 2020 sounds like a long time away. It's not, though, for candidates running for office. What sort of candidate, or what do you want your chosen candidate to say about these various institutions? We just talked about private prisons, Mary. Is there another industry we should take a gander at right now?
So I'd actually love to move into education.
Uh-oh. Is that me?
That's you.
All right. I am so excited. I put a lot of work into this. As in, this is going to be...
As in, not at all.
Listeners, you know me. If you don't, you can trust me.
You should listen more.
You should tune in. So jokes aside, yeah. So let's talk about the education system and also public versus private perspectives on it. I have a lot to say and not a lot of time to say it. So let's just skip the... I'm just kidding. So, all right. As you know, or as you said earlier, Matt, talking about charter schools, what you were saying, Mary, about the private prison system was very reminiscent to me about the debate in charter schools and school choice going on right now. So I'd like to...
That's frightening.
That's not the... Yes, I should clarify more. Very good point.
2 million children are imprisoned in charter schools this day.
Also, hopefully more than 2 million children are in school.
Hopefully.
Hopefully.
Well, let's back that up and let me clarify more. And say, with sort of the reward schemes and the less accountability that you're talking about with charter schools. So charter schools sometimes and or private schools have various accountability requirements that public schools don't have. And also you're saying, you know, private prisons can choose what inmates they have. Sometimes charter schools and private school, well, private schools definitely can choose what students they have. Public schools can't.
I also am just thinking of the funding mm-hmm. as you're speaking about this, and the just the fact that even though private prisons are private, they still receive government funding. And I believe that is the case, or is controversially the case with charter schools.
So this is the real kicker, right? Is that we're having government institutions that are traditionally entirely government run, but now becoming somewhat privatized, are still receiving government funding, but are run by private or outside organizations. And that's the problem.
Are they not subject to the same standards as a public institution?
Sometimes they're not. So a charter school, sometimes they are, sometimes they're not. The education system around the country is so disparate because it's up to the states and localities that it's hard to give one universal answer. But charter schools typically, traditionally, oftentimes will receive public funding, mean taxpayers' dollars, but can sometimes do their own thing.
Is this the case in New York?
I don't know. I would imagine it would depend on what the charter of the charter school is. So charter schools write a charter, as in their own sort of constitution of how they operate. And I don't know much about this at all. And I'm guessing that those can differ. But even it's hard to say. But the point is that the main problem with the debate is like we're giving taxpayer dollars to institutions that aren't being held accountable then to taxpayers' dollars, only to the students who happen to go to that school in particular, for example. And so when we're talking about this debate between school choice, I like to frame this in the school choice debate. You hear a lot about that now, whether it's charter schools, vouchers, magnet schools, tax credits and incentives.
Just really quickly, what is a school voucher?
A school voucher is a government subsidy for people to enter into a private school on a reduced rate. So essentially the government will say, here, family, here's money for you to go to a particular school that oftentimes you might not be able to afford.
A subsidy?
A subsidy. Yep. It's a subsidy. So it's the government giving people a subsidy. Yeah. Let me offer a theoretical framework for this. And this comes from a journal article in the, oh my gosh, you're going to love this. It comes from Educational Policy Journal. It's called K-12 Education in a Broader Privatization Context. It's by people whose names I can't pronounce, Henschke and Wolstetter. I'm sorry, authors. 2007, Education Policy, K-12 Education, K-12 Education, a Broader Privatization Context. These authors provide sort of a theoretical framework for different types of privatization. Type one privatization they're talking about is kind of like the big picture, what's government and what's not. And so, you know, in this type one privatization, you have a government could provide... the government could own, let's say, a Philharmonic orchestra. That would sound odd in the United States for the government to own an orchestra. But in other countries like Germany, for example, I think the authors say that the Berlin Philharmonic was run by the government or something. So that's just an example, big picture example, where these are really differ based upon cultures and societies. Like, what should the government own and what should it not? In American society, we traditionally say the government shouldn't own all that much, right? But in other societies, the government should own a ton of stuff.
Well, that's been the narrative of the last 40 years.
Particularly.
Coinciding with neoliberalism.
It does coincide. So it gets more interesting for our purposes here when we talk about the type 2 and type 3 examples of privatization. So type 2 privatization is what's called supply side privatization. That means that the government outsources various provisions of its supply to private organizations. So government is outsourcing the things it used to provide to private things that will now provide that service.
We see this all over the place.
All over
the place.
An
example would be like Amazon developing facial recognition technology for the government.
Mm.
There's also actually an example in mass transportation, which I talked about briefly last week, in which there are, you know, when cities had previously owned the transportation system, they might outsource to private companies to lower costs.
Yeah. And charter schools is the huge education example, right, for this, where, wait a second, I thought it was the government's job to provide education. Well, under type 2 privatization, charter schools still get government funding, but they're run by a private organization now. So that's type 2 privatization. Type 3 privatization is sort of the flip side. It's called demand side privatization, and that's where the government subsidizes consumers to access a service. So that's what vouchers are. That's the government saying, look, we're not going to give a subsidy to a private organization. What we're going to do is give you the subsidy as an individual, and you can decide where to get that service from. So often type 2 and type 3 go hand in hand, of course, but that's just an example of.
So are those vouchers then eligible to be used at public schools?
I'm not sure. Public schools are free, so why would they?
Well, there you go.
Like, I'm
shows what I know.
I mean, that's the point of public education, is that it's free for everyone.
Yes, but no, capitalism is all about presenting the illusion of choice, Jason.
So I hope that framework wasn't too much of a bore or too hard to get around, but there's different types of privatization, and in education there's so many different types, and that's why talking about school choice isn't as easy as talking about school choice. What you're really talking about when you're talking about school choice is the particular manifestation or example of how that school choice is in operation, and that has changed over time. Does that make sense?
I think so.
But the no, were you going to ask something? Sorry to interrupt you.
No. I was just actually, I hadn't really realized the difference between charter schools and public schools and private schools. So it's good to have that clarified. Like these different types of privatization is really fascinating. And I'm wondering, I know this is definitely focused on K-12 education, but is there a sort of parallel in higher education? Because obviously public universities are not free, even though K-12 education, public education, is.
Yeah, I
or
don't,
well,
I don't know.
Rather, in free, you know, quote unquote, it is paid through by taxpayers.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm not sure whether there's sort of tax incentives or vouchers for students to attend private colleges. I'm not sure. I attended a private college and I didn't know of any or access any. So therefore, it doesn't. No, I'm just kidding. There is one thing we didn't talk about, though, and that's tax credits. And this is routinely sort of in the discourse about providing tax credits for families who attend private schools. And this overwhelmingly benefits wealthy individuals and oftentimes white individuals. So if a parent or family member attends a private school, then they can claim that when they're doing their taxes, and they'll get a sort of a subsidy or write-off for that. And that overwhelmingly benefits wealthy people because, one, wealthier people are more likely to have the resources to access private education, and two, wealthier people are more likely to understand the tax code and how to benefit from it. And so arguably, you can make the argument that all sorts of these privatization efforts in education are to benefit wealthy people. Of course, the argument, the whole point of the discourse about providing private education is that it provides people choice, which is what you're going to, Matt.
Huh?
It meant we need to provide people choice. And yes. So here's the really interesting thing, though, when you're thinking about public or private education, is that school choice is only a means to an end. Because are people actually making the argument that we need to have school choice because choice is the end in and of itself?
I would think that the point of having a desire for choice is because there are problems with the system, with the current system, that need to be addressed. And privatization is a quick fix, so to speak, for those issues.
Yeah. I mean, I agree. And so that's what I think would make sense too. I don't know if there's individuals out there arguing that school choice is good because having choices is good. You know, that's like a market, free market, neoliberal value system thing. But essentially school choice is always a means to an end. And that's saying, look, our education system's broken. So how do we fix it? Let's privatize it. But of course, the counter argument would be, why don't you just invest more in public education to actually fix the system as a society, because we're all stakeholders in it. Because the more charter schools you open, the worse public education arguably becomes, because less money is going towards public education. People who support charter schools would argue against that and say, now public education has competition because there's charter schools that are opening up, so public schools have to up their game. But how can they up their game when they're receiving less money? And so it goes back and forth with this sort of debate. I want to sort of step back from all of that, though, and kind of go back to sort of what the point of public education is, though. And this comes from everyone's dark horse favorite founding father, if anyone even cares about the founding fathers anymore.
James Monroe. Yeah.
James K. Polk. Not a founding father, I don't know. This is a very famous quote from John Adams, the nation's second president, I think first vice president or something.
Is he a dark horse?
No.
Anyway.
Just making that up. But this comes from a letter John Adams wrote to a gentleman by the name of John Jebb in September of 1785. And so the famous quote from John Adams is this: "The whole people must take upon themselves the education of the whole people, and must be willing to bear the expenses of it. There should not be a district of 1 mile square without a school in it, not founded by a charitable individual, but maintained at the expense of the people themselves." The founding fathers are pretty conservative dudes in my mind, in many regards. Most of them own slaves and were white and wealthy.
I don't think that John Adams was probably talking about all people when he mentioned people in that quote.
Right, exactly. But here John Adams is saying, you know, public education should be born at the expense of everyone because it's really important. And I think, you know, if I see a candidate running for office, I would hope that they would say something similar to that effect. We're not seeing that at all right now. Mary, do I have time to get into the Trump budget? Can I please get into that?
Please go ahead.
All right. So listeners, as a reminder, on 100.9 FM WXIR, we're talking about public versus private today. We were talking about private prisons earlier, and we talked a little bit about school choice and public versus private education.
And I'm here.
And Matt is here as well, adding to the conversation. I would now love to talk about the budget that the White House released this week. I swear I will tie this into what we're talking about. So the White House releases a budget to outline the plans that the executive branch has for the country, essentially for the whole year. These budgets, in recent years, these budgets have not been taken too seriously because of the breakdown in sort of, you know, democratic norms and values and the sanctity of our institutions and their inability to function properly.
What are you talking about?
And so the problem with White House budgets is that they often are just like a wish list and sort of exemplify the president's true hope for the country of what direction it will go. Well, my friends, well, listeners, put your seatbelt on and let's hear what Donald Trump wants. I'm just kidding. Not to rail against Donald Trump.
This comes out every year?
Every year. Yeah. No, this is actually utterly despicable and disgusting and horrible. And there's no other way to frame the stuff that's in here.
And it does very kindly tie into our recent discussions about student loans.
Yes. Let's talk about it. So in this public versus private education, student loans, tying all these threads together, in the budget proposed by the White House, they want to have $5 billion of tax credits for people looking to attend private schools. $5 billion in tax credits. Again, those generally benefit the wealthy and the white.
Wait, one second. Would that be like K-12 vouchers?
K-12.
But for higher education?
No,
is that just for K-12?
This is
education?
All K-12. We're not student loans
fair
yet.
Enough.
Yep,
fair
this
enough.
Is all K-12.
I'm getting ahead of myself.
Yep. So K-12, public, private.
What is the point of aid if it's always going to the people who need it least?
Well, it depends on where your interests are.
I have a question.
Do tell, Matt. Do tell me the answer.
I don't know the answer.
I think I do, but I don't know if it's politically correct.
I think it has something to do with operating under a cost-benefit analysis.
And so the Trump administration wants $5 billion in tax credits for K-12 education. They want a $500 million expansion of charter schools, and they want $100 million more for magnet schools. So they're going full bore on school choice. They're saying school choice is great. And we just had a conversation lightly.
Why should
on
we rely
choice.
On the government to fix anything?
Right.
Let's open up the doors to all the companies out there that have our best interests at heart.
Yeah. Yep. Because that's how it works, public versus private. And now this is the kicker. So this is now we're going to higher education, talking about student loans. So this is a quote from the White House budget. It says, quote, "In recent years, income-driven repayment plans, which offer student borrowers the option of making affordable monthly payments based on factors such as income and family size, have grown in popularity. However, the numerous income-driven repayment plans currently offered to borrowers overly complicate choosing and enrolling in the right payment plan. This budget proposes to streamline student loan repayment by consolidating multiple income-driven repayment plans into a single plan. The single income-driven repayment plan would cap a borrower's monthly payment at 12.5% of discretionary income." Okay, we'll stop it right there for a second. Mary, you have a point.
Yeah, I do have a point, which is that currently, isn't it capped at 10%?
I believe so.
Which is less than 12.5%.
That's how math works.
Huh. Okay.
And so, yeah, so, you know, in our conversation about student loans, we're talking about income-driven repayment plans. Essentially, there's an option right now, if you have student loans, to be able to pay back your loans based upon your income. So that makes sense, because if you make a lot of money, you can afford to spend more of your income on your loans. If you make a lot less money and you're tied up with childcare, housing needs, healthcare costs, food, shelter, all the rest of it, then you can't afford to spend as much of your income towards loans, right? And so the idea of the income-driven repayment plan is that you can spend money according to how much money you have on your loans. The Trump administration is proposing to cap everyone's income-driven payment plan at 12.5%, meaning have a flat repayment plan, meaning it doesn't matter whether you're wealthy or you're poor, you're paying all the same amount, which has been the Republican tax cap, the flat tax cap for decades they've been trying to propose. But they go on to quote this too from the White House budget. "To support this generous pathway to debt relief for all undergraduate borrowers, the budget eliminates the Public Service Loan Forgiveness Program, establishes reforms to guarantee all borrowers in income-driven repayment pay an equitable share of their income, and eliminates subsidized loans."
Wait one moment there. So in this generous pathway, we are taking away choices of how we might repay our loans, and in fact eliminating loans that do not gain interest while someone is in school or in financial crisis?
Yep. You know what's the most insane part about this is that the conservative and the Republican argument forever has been like, we need to give people choices, right? Here's the quote from the budget from their budget proposal I just read, is that the numerous income-driven repayment plans currently offered to borrowers overly complicates choosing enrolling in the right plan.
Wait, so there's too many choices.
There's
now.
Too many choices, they're saying. And so they want to get rid of the choices and make everyone pay the same amount because they don't care about poor people or people in the middle class. It's insane.
It almost is like this isn't about choices.
Oh my God.
That's the most amount of emotion I've seen you display in...
I just can't.
Probably the last 10 years of knowing you.
I cannot get over this. This is absolutely insane. It is the most disgusting thing. It's one of the most disgusting things.
Jason is outraged.
How do we have this administration? How is this country? I don't understand the insanity of this all.
The good news is this is just a wish fulfillment on Trump's part, and that this is not likely to happen.
I think let's bring this back to...
pull me back, Mary.
No, but I mean, so what we mentioned at the beginning and throughout this episode is that one of the reasons that we're talking about public versus private is to have an idea of what our ideal candidate might look like. So we obviously know at this point, this is not it. So what out of this tax plan, or the, not the tax plan, but this new budget, is something that we find confusing, and how can we bring this into what we might desire in a candidate in a positive way?
I'm still recovering. I'm sorry, listeners.
That's okay. Pick yourself up. Dust yourselves off.
I believe I am not a very emotional person like that, but I think there are some things worth fighting for, and this is, it's just disgusting, you know, and there are some things worth calling out and being aggravated about, because fundamentally, when you have candidates like this, they want to ruin your life. You know, they want to make you a debt slave, and they want to make you a slave to the capitalist system and have no other option. And so that's what the Trump administration, the Paul Ryans, and Mitch McConnell's.
Taking away choice?
Yeah, they want to pretend to give you choice, and would actually just make you have no choices because you're in debt. And so I would like a candidate that doesn't do that. And that's basically anyone that's not a Republican at this point, you know?
And some Democrats too.
And some Democrats. Yeah. Absolutely. Any moderate Democrat or whatever.
Or whatever.
I mean, okay. Let me be more articulate. We could have candidates that are actually trying to fix systemic issues that are part of the perceived problem. So we just had a conversation about, why are we talking about choice? Well, we're talking about choice because it's a means to an end. And that end is somehow fixing public education. So we can have a whole conversation on what's wrong with public education. And I happen to have a theory about what's wrong with public education, is that we live in a society where a lot of people live in poverty and where a lot of people are segregated. And so what you see factually, objectively, time and time again across this country, and definitely in the city of Rochester, which has the most impoverished, one of the most impoverished and segregated communities in this entire nation, is that our school system is failing in many regards. And why is it doing that? Because of poverty and segregation. It is not doing that because of a lack of magical choice. And it will not do that by subsidizing magical choice.
These choices won't exist for the people who need them most, I think is the key point to make.
Correct. Because guess what? You get some students to go to those nice, fancy charter schools, private schools, magnet schools, whatever. You just push everyone else around into this toilet bowl, around and around in a circle, to go to keep going to a failing system. And then you keep weakening the public sector, you keep weakening the government, and so that essentially everything becomes privatized, and you can just blame problems on people's own faults, right? It's their fault for not having an education. It's their fault for not working hard enough, when the fundamental fact is society is broken because of poverty and segregation. I'd love a candidate to talk about that. Not taking away the public service loan forgiveness program, not having a flat tax rate, or not having a flat repayment plan on student loans, not subsidizing fake choice.
So, Jason, you've talked a lot about the negatives of vouchers and charter schools. What arguably would be then the benefits of public education? Like, why are so many people leaving? We've mentioned that it's broken, but what would be the ideal?
Thanks, Mary, for letting me focus on the positive. That's a good point that we weren't really talking about
here.
The positive. So, yeah, I mean, as that John Adams quote kind of shows, is that public education is the backbone of society. The idea behind public education is that regardless of your background, race, color, income, even citizenship status, right? Regardless of any of that, that you have access to a free education in the least restrictive environment possible. A free public education in the least restrictive environment.
Within 1 mile, I must say.
According to John Adams. But so the whole idea of public education is that everyone has access to the same foundational backbone that we can use, that you can use then to do whatever you want to do with your life. And so public education allows a great diversity to be had in the schools, in theory, because you're surrounded by anyone else, regardless of income and race and citizenship status, of course, again. But that doesn't work, though. The system's been broken because of segregation. And so the problem is that our schools are becoming less and less diverse because our society is becoming more and more segregated. And so, you know, that's a problem with with schools, but it wouldn't be if it wasn't a problem with society.
And when you're talking about segregation, are you talking more about racial segregation or class-based segregation or a mixture of the two?
A mixture of the two, particularly racial. I mean, we've seen that absolutely in Rochester, where the vast majority of schools in the Rochester City School District are made up of, you know, black and brown students. And those black and brown students tend to be concentrated in the city. Like, that's not a historical acumen. The government helps to create that problem along with societal racism.
Because Rochester was historically a redline city.
Yes, redlining, exactly. Yep. And also government subsidies that went to home loans after World War II that encouraged suburbanization and all the rest of it. And so the problems that we have are from policies and, you know, historical values. And so
it sounds like government vouchers have historically been an issue.
Anytime the government, you can make the argument that when the government favors a particular individual over another, you know, I mean, it depends. But it's, you know, so the pros of public education are that there's diversity, there's equality of access, and that there's accountability. And so when there's something wrong in public education, you can hold each other accountable for the issues. That's in theory.
In theory. But as you mentioned, Jason, while education is supposed to serve as this great equalizer for society, there are a number of people who often try to undermine that. And we have a great example that just broke this week, a story about a number of wealthy individuals who have been charged in a scam or attempt to bribe their children into attending elite schools across America.
Yeah, it was this Tuesday, March 12th. It was the largest college admission scandal ever conducted and sort of charged by the Justice Department, where there was 50 people charged with essentially cheating on college entrance exams, bribing coaches to accept and bribing coaches to accept students under false pretenses. So the idea was that these individuals were part of sort of a larger conspiracy to either cheat on the SAT or ACT and to essentially fake the fact that they were really star athletes and get them into essentially elite private universities.
Right. So in that case, they were being viewed as recruits for a certain collegiate team, which they never participated on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, at the center of this whole debate is a gentleman by the name of William Singer, and he ran a company called The Edge College and Counseling Network. And through that, parents essentially funneled money for their children to be fraudulently admitted to college. William Singer called this the side door admission to college, meaning, you know, everyone else has to go through the front door, but I can help out wealthy people go through the side door. And so I think that is a great example of the problem with the idea of education being the great equalizer, where, you know, even without this admission scandal, we know that wealthier people have an easier time getting into college. A, they have access to funds, so they can just go to whatever college they decide to go, but also their parents often have social capital, they have strong networks, and they're oftentimes wealthy donors to said educational institutions. And so, you know, the wealthy already have a sort of a privilege in this regard. And so this was, I think, as you're saying, Matt, you know, it sort of goes against the notion of education as a great equalizer. However, higher education is not K-12 education, right? We all have, again, the right to a free public education. That's not the same for higher education. So there's a little bit difference there.
Right. But we should mention that these children who were bribed into college, who had their parents' money grant them access to these elite institutions, they likely took the place of kids who would have gotten in based on their own merit.
Yeah, that's the idea, was that there was a lot of students who did do what they were supposed to do to get into the front door. They worked hard in school. They built up their resumes by doing volunteer hours and being athletes, and then they were kind of cheated out of their right to get into college.
So it is related, I feel.
There definitely is. And there's tons of debate about even affirmative action and whether or not institutions of higher education should privilege students of minority backgrounds or whatnot. And I think there's still a, there's outstanding litigation right now with Harvard, with Asian American students who are, who sued Harvard to say that they feel like they're being discriminated against because they often, or these students say, you know, Asian Americans often come to college with really high credentials, high test scores, but they won't get in because the colleges are letting other people of racial backgrounds in. And so Asian Americans are themselves a minority in society, but they're suing Harvard in this instance because they're saying that they're not allowed their fair shake to get into the college, even though they're a racial minority. So all the point is, all these things are really complicated and really delicate. And like, you know, government vouchers are not necessarily good or bad. One minority group, not necessarily good, or, you know, it's just, it's really complicated stuff. And my hope is that by articulating the purposes of what it means to have something be public, we prevent these problems from happening because of privatizing forces. You wouldn't have affirmative action if society wasn't segregated and impoverished to begin with. Wishful thinking, but what's the point of having a society if we don't fight for that? And so we just have a few moments left on 100.9 FM WXIR in Rochester. Mary, we were supposed to get to a few other institutions today, and we seem to always kind of run out of time towards the end of our shows, don't we?
Well, I think we may be a little bit idealistic in our intentions occasionally. Although for transportation, I did touch on public versus private transportation last week a little bit. So listeners, if you are interested in learning a little bit about public versus private mass transportation, so I'm not specifically talking about individual transportation like cars, but only really focusing on mass transportation, then you can look us up on YouTube for our past show. And I hope that we'll just get to healthcare in a future episode, because that is a big topic. And that is actually really being talked about in the 2020 election, the idea of Medicare for All, where we would expand the current elements of Medicare, which is limited to a specific population based on age and or financial ability, or financial resources. It is being talked about, and it is being actually written into legislation proposals to have a Medicare or a government institution, government healthcare institution for everyone.
Yeah, that of all the institutions we've talked about today, prison, education, and hinting at transportation, which we talked about last time, healthcare is the one that is arguably the one, there's a lot of steam behind it. And it's a huge issue right now. It was in 2018. It was beforehand. And we'll see where that goes with Medicare for All that some Democrats are proposing. The Republicans aren't proposing anything to fix or to change healthcare. They've for a decade railed against the Affordable Care Act, which was a fairly conservative proposal to begin with that came out of the Heritage Foundation. But we'll see where this debate goes.
Indeed we will.
And so listeners, I hope that you enjoyed listening to episode 47 of Evidence of Design. I almost lost it midway through the show, but thanks Matt and Mary for pulling me back from the edge reading Trump's budget proposal. Can't even very angry.
Can't even finish that sentence.
I've lost it. But, you know, there's a lot in that, and budgets are essentially moral documents, and where we put our money shows what our values are. And so let's think about that as we think about public versus private institutions and where we all stand on these. We wish we could have taken your calls and emails live. We'll be back for you live next week on Evidence of Design. You can always find our past episodes on YouTube by searching for the Evidence of Design YouTube channel. In the meantime, you can communicate with us at email at radioeod@gmail.com, on Facebook at radioeod,
on Twitter at radioeod. Did you say that one already?
You're catching on. No, I haven't. So anywhere, radioeod is our handle. You can guess what EOD stands for.
Evidence of derp.
Evidence of derp. Anywhere where that is. Thanks for listening, everyone. I was your host, Jason Taylor, joined by my good friends and co-hosts, Matt Treadwell.
I sleep in the daytime.
And Mary Lawrence.
I sleep whenever I can.
Be well. Be safe. Get some sleep. And bye-bye.